All right, so why don't we start then? I'll call the meeting to order. 5:30 ICOM time.
That's right.
Are there any additions to the agenda, or would someone like to approve it? Make a motion to approve it?
Motion to approve it.
Second?
I'll second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, reading the minutes of the previous meeting. Any questions or comments on this?
I move we approve the minutes from the previous meeting.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, minutes of the previous meeting passed, thank you. Financial report. Sue, you have any highlights for us on that?
Not anything too different from last time. I think most of the items that might catch your eye we've discussed before. We've had maybe one more repair item since the last meeting. So those lines are on the third page, the 5,000 series improvements and 5,200 improvements are considerably over. I don't think we have anything left that we need to work on.
I think we fixed everything.
I think we're set, so hopefully those numbers hopefully those numbers won't move any further than they already are. We've been having some very preliminary discussions of surplus. We will be seeing a rather substantial surplus in the health insurance line due to various reasons. And there are a few other lines in the budget that items we budgeted for and did not have to spend. So we're thinking we're going to have a pretty substantial surplus, but we will revisit that at the end of the summer in August when we have the meeting, when we're ready to close up the books.
And... okay, we'll leave it at that. Anyone have any questions on the financials?
At that point, we decide as a board what to do.
Yeah, usually what happens is Joe Cleveland and I will communicate as we go through the process during the summer. Joe already knows kind of where we are right now, and he will keep the Board of Finance informed of where we think our surplus will be.
Mm-hmm.
Traditionally, the Board of Finance will allow us to put up to $100,000 in the capital reserve,
mm-hmm.
and then anything above that will be reverted back to the town.
Mm-hmm.
When I spoke to Joe today, he didn't think that they would veer from that tradition, that mm-hmm. would probably still be the way that they would go.
And if traditionally, I think they really let us keep all the surplus
right.
to the capital fund, and then in the years when it's really been, you know, we've really had some windfalls and
yes.
good luck, then
yeah.
in that case we've,
yeah.
you know, taken over 100,000.
Yeah.
They regularly let us put all the surplus in our capital fund. And in particular this year, since our capital fund is so low, we've completed it with the windows and the oil tanks and the real repairs and renovations that we've done over the past couple of years. I think, you know, it's really up to them, but I wouldn't be surprised if they wanted us to put it all in the capital fund.
Mm-hmm.
What is our capital reserve at this point?
About $30,000.
Mm-hmm.
And that includes
the
$25,000 from this year's budget. Mm-hmm.
Okay, other questions on the financials?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Sue. School-related organizations, anyone here? No, doesn't look like it. Any communications to the board? I don't have any written communications. Chris, you don't got anything?
No, no.
Anyone have any oral communications to report before we get to Scooter?
Mm-hmm.
Scooter, would you like to let us know what's going on with Region 1?
Well, I guess as everybody knows, the budget did not pass. Apparently, there was some things about the contract, and if you've listened to the radio or if you've listened to Marshall, everybody kind of has an idea of what's going on. But the administration has opted to not take the extension for the third year on the contract, and the school has made some reductions. They were going to eliminate the regional athletic director that everybody went crazy for, but we fought for that to get that back, and we have that back on board. But they were able to reduce their revenues by $218,000, so our budget for the Region 1 is going up 0.07%, which really isn't that much, and we're taking out the third year of the contracts. Now, there has been a bunch of rhetoric and things, if you listen to the radio, about the contracts, but in the contracts, there is a terms of agreement. The contract runs from July 1st, 2011 to June 30th, 2014. Now, every year, the board has no later than May 1st to inform the superintendent concerning its decision to extend the contract, which we did. Their base annual salary each subsequent year of this contract shall be determined prior to July 1st. So under the agreement from the ABC committee, we granted them a raise, and then that, at that time, becomes part of the contract. So we did reach the agreement and passed for their raises, and like I said, it is part of the contract. So in my personal opinion, I really would like everybody to get out there and vote, and let's vote for this contract to go through. Let's save the taxpayers some money. It just seems to be the right thing to do and to fight it. The contracts have gone on like this for years, and we are going to have a study this summer to determine how the contracts are drawn up and how we will proceed with them in the future. So get out there and vote, everybody. Thank you.
Thanks, Peter.
Jennifer, can I tail onto that since I'm...
Well, let me make a clarification here. So just to make sure I understand, the administrators actually voluntarily relinquished the third year of the contract, which
right.
had been granted to them
right.
previously. So
right.
this was really a concession on their part.
This was a concession on their part.
Okay.
And which brought them back to the original contract with no extension. But there is a provision that we are able to give them raises every year. And we did vote and give them a raise for this year, and that is now part of their contract. So we really can't go back on that. We can only study from the future and figure out what we're going to do and fix it if there's anything wrong, but at least as a board, maybe it'll give us some starting ground that we all can work from, because I think that's what we need.
So at this point, the administrator contracts go through when?
They go through
June of 2013?
14.
So 2 years from now.
Right.
So we've just essentially completed the first year of a three-year contract, correct?
Right.
And now you guys are going to study, or someone's going to study and report back to you on ways that that's done around the state
right.
and some different alternatives
right.
that
well,
you might
Well, it's done like
at.
That around the state, quite a few places, quite
right.
a few schools. But we want to study it because there just seems to be so much hoopla.
Well, it does seem a little, I mean, if you think about how it's, if without being involved in the school district, if you just hear how it's set up, it's a little odd. I mean, the contract, and understand, you know, the school districts often do things differently, and the educational
right.
world operates differently from a lot of businesses. You know, we understand that. But, yeah, I think it's probably a good idea, and it's good for people to know that we're going to look at it again.
Right.
Or not.
That we are going to look at it.
But
it is also important that they know that they are eligible if, under our discretion to give them a raise every year, that can become part of the contract. And people don't seem to know that part. And so we keep having these votes, and you know, it's over $8,000 every time we have to do this referendum vote.
Plus?
Seems like a waste of money.
I just have a question. If I understand it, though, there's no bone of contention at this point because that third year has been rescinded.
Right.
That's correct?
Right.
Okay, and just to tag on to what Jim was saying, it seems that, and I think for what you're saying, it seems that the public really doesn't understand that, well, not just the whole thing, but that unlike the teachers' contracts where it's written in stone for 3 years, essentially you're trying to do the exact same thing, but on a year-to-year basis. And
well, maybe that's what you should be doing.
In terms of the salary, so my only point is I think the communication was very one-sided. I think it would have been very helpful for the public to hear more from, however that's possible, both from, you know, the board, perhaps the superintendent. I think it would have been, it might not have gone down this way. I think it was very unfortunate, because I think it would, I hoped, I wished it would have passed.
It just, right, it just seems like there's one side that you hear.
Well, it's a legitimate, I think that concern is legitimate. At the same time, it's sort of a communication issue, more than one's right and one's wrong.
Right.
And that's where it got caught up.
Patricia?
I would just say that Salisbury Town did pass it. It's just you were one of three that passed, so we appreciate your support and would encourage you to please get back out and vote. I hope that it isn't a personal vendetta of Kalon. I hope it's just about the third year, because that's what we were told. It's just about the third year. So the group volunteered, dropped that third year, and we were trying to communicate in the press consistently, but the message kept getting lost in the turmoil. But we were working very, very hard to communicate not only the process, but the legality of it, and it just wasn't getting out there. So we need to work harder at that.
From someone who did try to follow it, right, I found it even harder to,
right,
I don't feel that it really did get out to the point where I didn't have to work to get it.
Right.
It took a lot of effort.
Right. And I think the process is unique because the ABC group is the action group, all the chairs that really hammer out and negotiate. They come to that regional board with a recommendation because they are a committee of the board. They make their recommendation. Basically, the board accepts it or rejects it and sometimes says, no, we disagree, go back and do more work. This particular case, the board accepted the recommendations of the ABC with input on the superintendent only, because below the rank of superintendent, they're all basically teachers. You know, they're considered teachers, and they're not tenured administrators, but they are tenured in the system.
But those contracts are done in the same way. They're done on an annual basis.
Correct.
Which is different. Well, I was trying to show
that
the teacher's contract.
Absolutely.
Because that's clear as a bell to most people in the community.
Yes.
Whereas these administrative contracts, I think it's very confusing.
They are different. Unless the group unionizes, mm-hmm, which it could decide to do as a group. They would have to decide as a group. They won't be a group. They would have to vote. But below the level of superintendent, they can actually form a union. Would exclude Mr. Herrick as well. I would exclude him because we'd be negotiating against a group.
It's the salary that's looked at annually, but the contract goes, it's for a term of employment. So
correct.
They're actually two separate things.
That's correct.
And I would say that, you know, democracy is wonderfully messy. And, you know, I think it's important that people understand. And, you know, if we have to do two referendums, then maybe we need to listen harder to the pulse of the community. But that's democracy for you.
Mike has something he wanted to say.
Yeah, I'm just on this issue, you know, I'm listening to all the conversation and people are being nice in some cases. The process itself is a long-standing process. It's not so far out there per se, except that we have the unusual character of being a region that's not truly a region per se, but rather individual districts. The contracts, if you look across, are pretty standard contracts for administrators in the state of Connecticut, to be honest. Most of them are left open on a year-to-year basis on salaries and such. So, you know, I would say to everyone, be careful what you're hearing, because unfortunately, the media has been leaning in one very hard direction, and part of the media has been advocating the defeats of these budgets and is already starting to advocate the same once again. Now this time, they decided to make cuts within the school, within pupil services, within the RSSC. The board saved something that you folks, I know some of the folks here have been involved in, but that doesn't mean that if we send, and this is the way it's couched, a message, that message is not going to result in even further cuts affecting our kids' educations. And as well as it is that, you know, $7,000, $8,000 per referendum, that's also money that's going to have to come from somewhere. From somewhere. Our superintendent and the rest of the administrators who have been drug in are not overpaid in the state for what they do, quite frankly. None of them has done anything that I've seen as criminal or wrongdoing. There is a process here that someone has seized onto and is using it as a tool, and now everyone believes it's a process you can't understand. Folks, I tell you, it's a process that's easy to understand. And I'm hoping that board members, I have been writing letters. As a matter of fact, I wrote a letter to the Journal today about this next one because the window's so tight. But I'm hoping all the board members will get out there and say to people, I sat at the poll all day, get our parents out. I'm going to say directly, you need to vote for this and not allow this rhetoric to go on. And then when it's done, allow this board to look at this process. Everyone needs to educate and start tuning in and listening very careful to what's being thrown at you across airwaves, because some of it's infected.
Thank you, Mike. And that actually is an excellent segue into, let me make sure I have my agenda correctly. Well, I guess we'll talk about that under the superintendent's report.
Right.
Because I do want to talk about what we should do as a board and as individuals and as a school in terms of the next budget referendum. But that takes us to, anyone else have communications to the board? All right, so Chris, why don't you do your principal's report and then we'll go to the superintendent's report.
Okay, that's pretty quick. So I just wanted to give the board an update on our scoreboard venture. You may remember that we were looking at replacing our aging scoreboard. Kay Lindsay, our girls basketball coach, has been really instrumental in helping us look at the fundraising process and help us raise money for this. At this point, we're actually a little bit ahead of where I thought we would be. Giving you some details here, the scoreboard cost is about roughly $5,500. We've had very generous support from our PTO, who has said they will give us $2,500 towards the scoreboard. The Region 1 Athletic Fund, which Kay applied to on behalf of our school, has awarded us a $1,000 grant. And Salisbury Recreation has said they would give us at least $100. So we've already accumulated about $3,600. And so our balance is $1,855, roughly, plus the cost of electrical work. Initially, I was thinking that this might be a two-year process to raise the money for the scoreboard, but we've made such progress already. I would like to purchase the scoreboard this spring or early summer so that we could have it installed in time for basketball season in the fall. I don't have a specific, it wasn't initially in the budget line, I don't have a specific line for it, but you know, given the fact that we're looking at a pretty sizable surplus for this year, this might be the time to jump on board and get the scoreboard now. So I just wanted to let the board of ed know where I am with that and what my intention is.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Okay. You're welcome. Just a few announcements. Our eighth grade is getting ready to go to their Washington, D.C. trip again already next week. They'll be spending 4 days and 3 nights in Washington, D.C. During their time in the nation's capital, they'll visit many monuments and memorials, visit the Smithsonian Institute, take walking tours of Arlington National Cemetery, and there's several evening events as well, including a play and a boat cruise. So we wish our eighth graders and their chaperones a wonderful week next week and hope it's not too hot, but very pleasant weather. Just a reminder that this Friday the 25th, we'll be having an early dismissal day for teacher professional development. We traditionally use this date to continue the process of getting our class lists ready for next year. We've started that process, but we really need that teacher time for teachers to communicate and help make good decisions. Speaking of classes for next year, this is my annual May sort of update on classroom assignments for next year, just so the board and the public in general is aware. A few changes in the elementary school. We've had to shift from three sections of K down to two, so we've moved some people around. Mrs. Conklin will be going to first grade. She's been doing kindergarten or first grade for a few years now, so she's sort of our swing person in that area. Pleased to announce that Mr. Sella will be coming down from fourth grade to become part of the third grade team with Mrs. Fales and Mrs. Fazzino. And Mrs. Higgins will be coming down from fifth grade and joining Mrs. Dowd in fourth, which opens up a slot for Mrs. Ballow to join Mrs. Carr up in fifth grade.
She's been teaching first?
She has been teaching.
I mean, I know she used to teach fourth.
But she was a fourth grade teacher for a few years, so. so she has some experience with that intermediate age. In the middle school, for the most part, things are just about the same. We have a few just, you know, small changes depending on, because of our large eighth grade class this year, so a few people will be picking up an extra section here or there to cover all the classes. But in general, people will be working within their content areas that they love. And the back page, I'm not going to go through all this list, but just so you know all the exciting things that are happening at Salisbury. This is such a busy time of year for us. A few field trips left, and then just tons and tons of events coming up. So please take a look and peruse and look at all those exciting dates, and you'll probably be involved with at least one or two of them. And we're ending the year. June 13th is our 8th grade graduation, and 14th is our scheduled last day of school. So hopefully no snow days between now and then.
Don't even say it. Oh.
Chris, how long is that K-5 concert that's on May 24th?
How long is it?
Just wondering.
Interminable.
She was going to be so excited every moment.
Just long enough to show the amazing skills of our students.
Just the right length. Right. That's a great answer.
Just the right length. Why are there two 8th grade technology teachers, Mr. Perry and Mr. Conklin? Do they teach different things?
Or no, actually it's one of the many details that have to work out because of the large 8th grade class.
Oh.
Those students would be, there's going to be three sections of 8th grade technology.
Okay.
It has been Mr. Conklin up till this date doing the 8th grade, but he's going to also have three sections of science because of the large class for 8th grade, and then he does his two 7th grades. So there wasn't enough periods in the day for him to do all the 8th grade technology as well. So it's actually a great opportunity because it's going to, Mr. Perry's excited to take on that challenge, and you know, we're sort of spreading the knowledge through the middle school so that, you know, many teachers are aware of what's going on with those classes.
Great. Okay, anybody else have questions for Chris? Thank you, Chris.
My pleasure.
All right, so Patricia, do you want to do your announcements first?
Sure.
And then we'll talk about the referendum.
Sure.
Plan?
Just, you know, that we're all rushing right to the finish line, and we have graduations everywhere, and some board meetings still happening in the process. So be a listener, stay tuned, watch for the budget. I put in front of you the yellow sheets, which represent the cuts that were made in the last budget vote, the reductions. And if you look at the back side, you'll see Salisbury is reduced by $54,000 as a result of your percentage of share in this. So that gives you an idea of where the board went to find their reductions, and it ranged from a dust collector to some assistant coaches that were proposed. Those were actually third coaches that were proposed. There were already two, and there was an interest in maybe increasing those to a third. The indoor track, I think, is the only one that's affected in such a way that it could become more of an intramural type club versus an indoor track in a competing group. There are 11 or so students, I believe, involved currently. Of that group of 11, there's quite a few seniors, so we're losing a good size. But of all the other issues on this page, you'll see very little that actually impacts students directly, which was our goal. So that gives you a little bit of an idea of what the board's been working on. And I think along with the concessions, it's an excellent budget, a 0.07 increase. The only increase is the 10,000 that we actually put back in, which was the middle school AD. So you see a little 10,000 for the AD is what bumped that budget, 0.07, which is an outstanding budget, really. I also put in front of you just a quick summary of the vote to help people understand what the vote is. There can be confusion with a second referendum. People think they've already voted and it's over, and maybe haven't tracked. So we want to make sure we encourage people to vote. And that is all I think I have on the budget at this point.
Okay.
I have much more detail I can share with you. I provided you with the top five or so pages from the budget in your packet, which really gives a summary of not only expenses but revenue as well, just to give you an overview. And the entire budget is available also in the town halls, or I'd be happy to have one sent to you via email if you want the entire budget.
Okay. Okay. Other announcements or not? All for my announcements. All right. So, what are our what is it that we as a board, as individuals, as a school, can do to support the regional budget referendum?
Boards typically do advocate for budgets to pass. That's what board members do. You know, you're there for your students and the community. You cannot use tax dollars to advocate. So you can't come into the school and use school equipment, or you can't run things on copy machine if you're advocating a position. You can if it's just a simple fact statement like this: where, what, when. Those are all fine to go out because, again, you want to encourage people to vote. But if you're advocating one way or the other, it's really either an individual task or it's done outside of the school taxpayer dollars. If you want to advocate as a board or you just want to vote a motion of support, you can do that. There's nothing wrong with a board taking a vote about an endorsement or support of a regional budget. So, in essence, you can't use children to deliver a message if you're advocating for or against. You can't use taxpayer dollars if you are advocating. If you are simply saying, here are the facts, then you may use papers, flyers, emails.
But if we vote as a board to support the budget and urge people to vote to support the budget.
You can do that.
And we pass that at this meeting. How can we display that or get that word out without doing it individually?
I think that that becomes part of your minutes. Your minutes are obviously a public record.
And everyone watches it on TV.
Yeah, everyone watches it. Yeah.
We don't have our newspaper represented.
Yeah,
would it be wrong to write that? Or if that, I'm just trying to think, if that was printed by one of us at our home and brought to school and posted,
yeah.
Is that?
It can be. I'm just confused because most of that budget is the high school expense. Then there's the pupil services and administration. But what role does our board have in the high school budget?
That we're taxpayers in the town of Salisbury.
Right.
It's a three-part budget.
Taxpayers.
It's three-part budget. The high school is obviously a large share of it. Pupil services, which is part of that central office, and the RSSC. So you have RSSC, which is basically your central office administrators. You have pupil services, both regional programs. How it impacts this group directly is if we end up reducing staff, that staff member could be in any of your schools, frankly. And your pupil service staffing would be billed to that budget. So that would be a direct impact. I don't know if that wasn't on the table, and it isn't on the table, but it could be on the table. So that would be one way it impacts you. It impacts you in terms of services also, the central office services. What it probably also impacts you is the programming offered to your high school students, because your students go to the high school. You pay their tuition. The children, the high school students of Salisbury, are basically impacted by you, so.
So I think it's more of a gesture.
Yeah, it just is unprecedented for this board to take a stand on the.
Yeah, I think it is, but I've been thinking about it, and it resonates with me in terms of our students going to the high school.
Right.
And the opportunities that they have at the high school. I mean, I don't necessarily, I don't know. I don't know. What do you guys think about that? I don't have, it sort of came to me because, I started thinking about it because the school board chair, a number of boards ago, you know, 10 or 12 years ago, before Roger, said, well, you guys didn't call people. She said, you know, when I was board chair, we all got on the phone and we called everybody in town and told them get out and vote. I said, oh. She said, aren't you going to do that? I said, I don't know. We haven't done that in a long time. I don't know. So anyway, so I mean, that's one of the things that, you know, I know that you guys sent out an alert now message, but
yes, we did.
Alert now messages are kind of impersonal.
Yeah.
And, you know, not not the first thing that people look at to open.
And
it's not really an appeal to an individual.
No, you could not advocate.
And if you aren't feeling close to the region one anyway, because maybe your kids go to the private school and the high school, or you only have little kids or whatever, then that's not necessarily something you're gonna.
Exactly.
Whereas if, you know, I talk to someone that I know and say, look, this really matters, even if you don't have kids at the high school, you know, get out and vote, that might be more of an appeal. I don't know.
I just see that there's been a lot of political controversy, and for our board to come out in this particular budget season as this just kind of throws more fuel to the political part of this, the
Does
focus.
It though?
I think so, because I do think so. I mean, I think it'd be great for us all to act as individuals and get out the vote, you know, and to write letters as taxpayers as we see fit, but I just am reluctant to do it as a board. Because I see our first mission is the business of this school, and not to get involved in the political, you know, hotbed.
Now,
Region 1 budget issues.
Although I guess I would say I see our mission. I mean, I understand your point, but I think I see our mission as to the students of Salisbury,
right?
Four grades of whom are not in our district. And I mean, they happen to live here, but we're not in charge of their education. So I kind of see this as us advocating on their behalf.
I would also say we did not, since our representative on the ABC committee, we elect a representative to represent us on the ABC committee, which is what, where this started.
Yeah, we don't even elect him. I mean, I guess
we nominated him. You know.
Right.
And we do not give input to that representative to make that recommendation. So it sort of separates us, and I question whether it should, in terms of how the ABC made their recommendation in the first place. Not that I'm saying it was wrong or right, I'm just saying part of the, from my understanding, part of the communication was that it represented our views, which is not correct. We did not give our position to be taken to the ABC in that regard. So, you know, I question whether it's something that...
I think, Claude, and certainly with the area of the superintendent, you each provided your view, I believe.
We did,
the
superintendent,
support, yes,
right,
absolutely.
But below the rank of superintendent, you would not, because
right.
Then you would be evaluating people, so.
Right, but I'm saying that discussion of sort of that negotiation that
yeah.
takes place, we are separate from that, and
yes.
our representative
that's
is
right.
not.
That's right.
And that's, I guess, what I'm pointing to, and I think some of that is where the political disagreement might have arisen. It's not so much in the support of the superintendent or the other administrative positions, it was sort of how the, you know, how those contracts evolve.
Right.
And I think at some point, I just wish, you know, if people had said, look, this is, we can look at this, we intend to look at it, it's not a perfect situation. And I have a feeling the budget might have passed if enough communication had gone out saying, okay, it's not a perfect system, it's done around the state in many places this way, in places it's not. But at least if someone acknowledges that it needed to be, it was going to be looked at, might have squashed the level of discontent.
But going forward, so what does that mean in terms of what you think this board should do, what you would like to see this board
do? I don't
now.
Disagree with what Amy's saying. I question whether we have some responsibility from the get-go, other than just saying, yes, it's great to say we support the superintendent, but then where it went after that is where the mess went. And we didn't have any, our hand was not on that.
Right. So tell me what, tell me where we're going now.
I am not against supporting the vote.
So what are you in favor of? We know what you're not against.
I think the converse is pretty clear.
Aren't you glad you guys didn't elect me?
I'm perfectly happy to write it my own to the paper, but and I'm perfectly happy to support whatever, you know, motion on this floor if we want to support the vote.
I think it makes a stronger statement as if we pool our approval, and as opposed to doing individual things. And I think that it would hold a little bit more weight if the Salisbury Board of Education supported it. And I would be in favor of doing that.
I think we should consider what message it would send if it weren't a unanimous vote, though.
Right.
So before we decide to do anything, that would probably be something to think about.
Definitely.
Anyone else have thoughts on that?
Can I ask a quick question? And I won't say nothing more. How many board members voted at the last referendum? Did all the board members vote?
I was there. So there were...
I was out of town. I wish I planned to be back in time to vote.
Absentee ballots.
No, I planned to be back. I made every effort I could to get back, and I was very upset.
Okay. Anyway. So having had this discussion, sounds like there's not a lot of energy around making phone calls.
We didn't discuss that.
You mentioned it. I mentioned it, but no one jumped in and said, oh, that's a great idea. So I'm just taking that to the logical, making some logical, drawing logical conclusions. And should we send this home in Friday folders? We could personalize it by, you know, removing all these other
towns,
and just say, Salisbury parents, please vote. And then, you know, if we get the file from Patricia, I imagine that wouldn't be too hard to do. As long as
we
have less of a
red. Could we put something about why it's important to vote on this?
Mm. Only that the more we change it, the more work someone has to do on it, and I'm looking at Sue.
That's true, but I'm just thinking, you know, general Joe Smith public, like, what happens if I don't?
Right. And really, if you don't have a direct interest, you know, if you don't have a child there,
maybe elaborate a little more on the regional budget, district budget, what that means.
What it
it's
means
high school, it's, as Amy said, it's pupil services, it's RSC.
That's there. Why it's important.
Well, and the fact that if it fails again, there's the $9,000, $8,000 referendum cost.
You know, one of the things.
Well, I mean, that's a big
thing. That sort
of sends a message. It appeals to, I mean, that's the kind of number that might get somebody's attention if they have no other connection to the school.
I
mean, if you're just a taxpayer who has no kids anywhere.
So you might want to say vote in the second referendum.
I was just thinking that second referendum. So people also distinguish, like, it gets very confusing. People are voting on the local budget, the elementary budget, and they think they've already voted on the high school budget. And mm-hmm. may not be following it, so I think second referendum is a great idea.
I think also if you could add information about what has happened since the first budget, you know, what has
right.
changed, you know, what's...
All right.
Are you thinking your office is willing to do it?
Okay.
Excellent.
Thank you. Yeah, you can make the backside.
Yeah. I was going to say, would it be really awful if we just sort of included this somehow.
I think this is confusing.
I think this is confusing too. I'm afraid of this.
I'm just the big issue about the contract, and that the budget is now at point, what did you say?
0.07.
I mean,
yeah. What I also would recommend is, what is regional school district number one? You have Housatonic Valley Regional High School grades 9-12. Then you have Pupil Service Center of Special Education and Regional School Services Center Central Office. I don't think that people realize that special, I mean, all those people realize that there is special education at Salisbury Central, that this special education.
So that's region-wide.
Exactly.
Region-wide,
exactly. K through 12.
It should say K-12.
In all six towns of region one.
Oh.
Yeah.
I think they both should say, well, K-12, 9-12 in the high school, and then K-12 in the other two.
Exactly.
Get it?
Yeah. Exactly. Okay. Exactly.
That's a good point.
Yeah, because we have neighbors new to town. They don't have kids. They don't.
Right.
You know,
right.
And so if you actually sent this electronically, And people could forward it.
Right, we could post it on Facebook.
Right, but
we could email it to friends.
I mean, that would be an additional way, but if people have to take a step to open up an attachment, it goes right
but
in
it's
there.
A, it's a personal
right.
email, not coming
right.
from, it would be
right.
coming from me, so they would
right.
like
right. right.
I'll try to
right.
summarize this sheet to some extent and just put in a few simple,
mm-hmm.
as Amy said, the contracts.
Yep.
Yeah, because you don't get that out of this or this. I mean, the,
right.
The, what seemed to me to be the major opposition has been dealt with.
And if it could just be where is your folding place?
Right, and then
it would be
cut
easy
all that
to,
space.
It would be easy to make one for each of the towns that way, just plugging that stuff in so it'd be town specific.
Okay.
I can do that.
Yeah, as long as there's an advocate.
Right.
Yeah, and this doesn't advocate.
I was thinking we could take what Trudy Allen does on Fridays is she sends an email out reminding parents to look at the Friday folder on the website, but instead of doing that, send the same group an email that contains this document.
Mm-hmm.
So they get it directly in the email instead
right.
of having to go
rather
to the
than
website
having
to
right
do it.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, I think that
and do it
great.
As an attachment.
Mm-hmm.
We could do that.
Mm-hmm.
And then you would... Stephanie, get it as a parent, and you could forward
right.
it
we could forward
to people
it to
and catch
it.
Mm-hmm. You know, all parents could do that.
Can I ask a stupid question?
So wait, let me just make sure we're clear on this. If this is generated using school funds, even though it's not advocating, can we then as individuals forward it to advocate, using it to advocate?
Yes, as an individual.
Okay.
Yeah, with our emails, we can send to our list and with a note saying,
you can't send it with children.
Right, right.
Right, if you're advocating.
And you can't sign it from your friend, the board member.
Right.
Your trusted friend.
Ooh.
Okay. All right, somebody else.
I have a question. What at this point is the objection to the budget? I guess I don't get that part. Why is there continued objection to this?
I don't know. I have not followed blogs that I'm hearing people are on, but the issue initially seemed to be the length of the contract. So once the group made a concession on the length, now the issue is likely to become something else, because I think it's a personal vendetta. And
that'll clarify it.
I think the rules keep changing, so that's what I think it is, very clearly.
Hmm.
So.
Okay, so. Anyone else have any questions on these issues? What we may and may not do, what we will and will not do, what we could or could not do. thank you, Patricia, for bringing that, for putting this together, and for being willing to edit it for us.
I'll play around with that. I think, to your point, I think it should say vote second referendum budget reduced to 0.07. I think that needs more.
Yeah, 0.07%.
You know,
contracts.
And it's factually correct to say the third year.
Third year's
been. Which is
And I'll add that. I'll add that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
One last question. How late can you do an absentee ballot? If you're out of town, you expect you that you can't just do it.
Yes, you can.
You can.
In a referendum, yes, you can. It's a special type situation.
I'll ask you after.
You go right into the town clerk's office, you fill it out.
No, I'm saying if you're not here, you can't be here.
Hmm?
If you expected to be here and you are delayed.
Right.
Because I thought about calling at the last minute, but I mean, I didn't know.
Yeah.
Oh, no. You
can't.
You
have
to personally get it. Yeah, so you do that ahead of time.
Just if you think there's a chance you might not make
it. I didn't think there was a chance
in
the world.
All right.
It didn't work out.
So, Patricia, you don't have anything else?
I do.
You do?
I'm sorry
okay.
to do this to
you
guys,
okay.
but and it's actually quite a bit. But this is a summary of the legislation that occurred most recently in May 8th or 9th. I just wanted to highlight a few of the acts. It's a 47-page summary.
Wow.
You will. I can send
that's
it to you electronically.
47 pages.
Can you imagine that? Yeah. There's just so much here. Eventually, this will be condensed even further, and we'll get you down to 4 or 5 pages, of which I will make sure you have copies of. A lot talking about the Education Reform Act that we've been talking about for some time, with a heavy emphasis on school readiness. That's the primary. They increased the seats to 1,000 preschool seats, which I think is very exciting and remarkable.
it will be to the priority schools, and it'll be those second-tier schools under that priority group will have access to those early childhood seats. There's also early childhood education facility study. Again, they're going to be looking at spaces that are required for programs. Early childhood. New statewide reading assessments. This is really intriguing. The bill requires the State Department of Education by January 1, 2013 to develop or approve reading assessments that districts must use to identify K through third grade students who are reading deficient. We are using, and I'll read a few of these, and you're going to recognize that you're already ahead of the curve, include frequent student screening and progress monitoring. If you're using AIMSWEB, you are providing frequent student screening and progress monitoring. And some of this is going to sound an awful lot like RTI, because it is. Measure phonics, phonemic awareness, fluency, vocabulary, and comprehension, just all the components of early reading. Allow for periodic formative assessments during the year. RTI would require that. Students identify with deficits. Produce data that's useful for developing individual and classroom instruction, and be compatible with best practices in reading instruction. So they really are very clear that they want that continuous monitoring, progress monitoring, and the response to intervention plan that we've established, those tier two students are getting a lot of that. So even the tier ones are having frequent assessments, but the tier twos certainly are being monitored. Reading teacher exams, teachers that are instructing students K-3 will take an exam, basically. It'll be a practice version of a State Board of Ed approved exam. Each local and regional board shall annually report the results of such practice examinations to the Department of Education. So all certified employees, teachers and administrators working in grades K-3, this will be very interested. I mean, I don't even know how we're going to do this, let alone how we're going to record the results and report those results. So that's something you'll have to work on.
This is a test of teaching reading?
I believe so.
Not a reading test.
I think it's a teaching reading.
Teaching.
Why administrators?
They want them to know, I guess, first what the test is about, probably, as a learning tool. And you're going to see later, as they're instructing and working with teachers, through observations, they want the principals to be able to evaluate what quality reading instruction looks like. Professional development in reading. They would now say that reading instruction for teachers counts towards professional development, be based on reading assessment data, so it has to be based on data, provide differentiated and intensified training in teachers' reading instruction, outline how model classrooms will be established in schools for reading instruction, inform principals on how to evaluate classroom and teacher performance in a scientifically based reading research and instruction, and be job embedded and local wherever possible. And I think we've talked about this. The trend is moving away from workshop to more training in the classroom side by side, what we're considering job embedded instruction, which actually makes a lot of sense. It'll take us some time to get there. There's a whole section on family resource centers and school-based health clinics. Our 2013 bill provides 10 new family resource centers. Again, those go into the priority and high need schools. Physical exercise requirement for K-5, there's a minimum of a total, actually, of 20 minutes of physical exercise in each regular school day for students K-5. There's some unions way for new teachers, school district cost saving grants. They're going to be encouraging these small districts to look for ways to save money through grants, which I think is really interesting. Open choice program incentives for the larger districts. Those are districts with 4,000 or more students. Exemplary schools, they'll be identifying outstanding schools. We have to post on our website the Oliver Wolcott technical option our students have. We would post that the vocational agricultural program at the high school is available in the high school. So again, getting word out, we have to also post if there's an alternative high school, and we do have an alternative high school in Winston. Uniform system of accounting and charts of accounts, that was very interesting to me. I think we have a very unified system in the state.
We do have a quarterly reporting for any grant expenditures, and the state's very explicit about the information they want, so I'm not sure how this came to be, but we will do whatever they need us to do. The study of small grant districts issues, there's a committee that's required to study schools with less than 1,000 students called small districts. There's financial disincentives they want to look at, such as small district reduction percentages for small districts whose pupil services cost exceed the state average for the prior year. State average is roughly about $14,000 per student. Your per pupil is probably up and around 20, would be my guess. Financial incentives for the schools to consolidate. So it's going to be the incentives and disincentives. $100 per student ECS grant regional bonus, as well as the effects of other state reimbursement bonuses for regional districts and cooperative arrangements. And the ECF minimum budget requirement is being looked at as well. It defines small districts, as I said, and they're interested in looking at a 10% reduction in the first year. So if you exceed the state average, they want to reduce your ECS grant by 10%. They will do that every year for 5 years until you reach 50% reduction if you are over the state average by 10%. So it's going to...
I thought they didn't discuss this and didn't pass it.
Well, this is all committee. This is nothing.
So it's going
nothing
back.
Is passed. This is going all back to a committee. Mm-hmm. But they are quite specific about what they want the committee to study. This study group will actually look at these points. So that's something to just be aware of and know that it's out there. There's going to be a new school performance index called SPI, of which schools will be ranked from 1 to 5, 1 being the highest score, 5 being the lowest. And there's a lot on
the
school performance index. Yes, it's very complicated.
This is in committee too.
This one is going to happen. Actually, you know what?
Who's going to administrate all this stuff?
That's my worry. Gets to be pretty sizable. Revamps the educational accountability. It creates new categories. So this will happen. This is not for study. You're going to be identified in the old way was your school is in need of improvement. You remember that on AYP? You need improvement or you don't. Mm-hmm. So now they're refining those categories to those 5 categories. If you think of a Likert scale, 1 being the best in this particular case, we would all hope to be in tier 1 or 2.
And when will the first one of these come out?
That's a very good question. It's going to take a little bit of time to do this.
You're
retiring in 2014, I see. June 30, 2014. So it's not a lot of time. They have a year to ramp up. 5, having the lowest performance as indicated by factors, and that they may include SPI. Changes in SPI over time, student achievement growth, high school graduation, and dropout rates overall for subgroups of students. And that's a low performing. And the high performing ranked as having the highest performance of any schools based on the same factors listed above. So they've taken out sort of a rubric and scored.
And how does that translate into financial terms? If you
end up...
If you score high, do they punish you and take away money?
Sort of. If you end up in several of these tiers, you're going to be in that need improvement, and there will be requirements that could include even boards being taken over by the state. So that's one of the activities you see later. And the next 30 pages is just about that. You know, how are we going to transition to this new plan?
The small thing, though, January 1st, 2013, the study.
Yeah.
So that's pretty quick.
I did something.
How that could affect us.
So this new plan will continue to June 30, 2012. They're going to be monitored by the State Department of Ed beginning July. This is something I think that's going to be interesting to see if they can pull this off quickly. Are evaluated by local and regional boards in 2012, are subject to statewide performance and management and support plan if they fail to make adequate yearly progress, are subject to rewards and consequences as defined in management and support plan, and continue to be eligible for available federal or state aid. So to Stephanie's point, if you don't comply, the threat is we'll take away your state funding. That would be the low-achieving school districts. It goes on and on and on. Comptroller's authority to withhold ECS grant funds. It was repealed. Their school governance councils were removed. There was an act that created the school governance councils, but because we have so many school boards, we were never required to form those up, so we didn't. Reconstituted school boards. There's a commissioner network of schools, which we wouldn't want to be in. If you're in that network, there's an expectation that you're a turnaround school. It talks about a turnaround committee that will be appointed to those schools in need. There's a network school audit and inventory that happens. It's just huge. Then there's a turnaround plan.
It's so massive.
Yeah, it's huge. Then there's a turnaround plan, which is really difficult, I mean, I would imagine. Some of that will be supported through the local RESC. Our RESC would be Education Connection, and we're not gonna fall into these categories. Mm-hmm. Limits on
a lot of job creation.
Yeah. Limits on assigning control to nonprofit management, there's some work on that, what you can sub out, so to speak. Partnering to compile best practices, so there's an interest in the state in identifying what are best teaching practices. That's happening through teacher evaluation plans, as we all are looking at frameworks for teacher evaluation plans. Collective bargaining and contract modification and election to work agreements. So it was a discussion about how they would be dealt with in these turnaround schools, because obviously the contracts could have impact on a board's decision to lengthen the school day, for instance. This just basically says that they will negotiate. There's some transitions out of the network if you're successful, an audit from the commissioner, and then there's reporting requirements. The rest is collective bargaining. Collective bargaining in those schools.
There's been a lot of discussion recently about teacher performance incentives and that kind of thing. Has any of that kind of stuff made its way into anything that we're going to have to worry about immediately?
Not coming our way immediately, but I think in years ahead, that's going to be a future. There are some districts that have incentives built in. I believe New Haven actually might have incentives built into their plan, and they are being touted as a model plan. Grants to charter schools. There's a whole another dozen pages just on charter schools and grants and support of charter schools, new charter schools, waiverly of enrollment, opting out and alliance districts for charter schools. So all of that's all charter school based, and we do not have a charter. Expanded classroom experience requirements for a teacher preparation program. There's a sense to get teachers in the field doing clinical work for 1 or 2 years minimum. So those will be changes in teacher preparation programs in the future. It'll take some time again for higher ed to catch up, which also makes a good deal of sense. There's changes in the professional educator certificates, when those can be achieved. There's an exemption from the TEAM program if you have taught out of state in other districts. The TEAM program is that support program for beginning teachers. There's going to be a distinguished educator designation. This will establish a new distinguished educator designation for a person who holds a professional educator certificate. So part of that certificate will say you are a distinguished educator. Professional development was talked about considerably. If you recall, we have to have 90 CEU hours, which are credit hours, educational hours, every 5 years. That has changed somewhat. The principals still need 15 hours in teacher evaluation, but the teachers don't have that requirement that we had in the past, so there's a little more flexibility. 15 hours every 5 years in teacher evaluation was held in. For those with elementary and middle school and academic endorsements, at least 15 hours in computer technology. So the technology held in to the requirement. But apparently we do not have to track or keep track of CEUs, so I think the debate is should we do it for a few years just to see if it comes back. And I hate to lose all that data that we have collected.
Have to go back and...
So there's some audits and penalties associated with that. The teacher evaluation program bill expands the required components of, one, the state guidelines for a model teacher evaluation program. Local school districts, teachers and administrators evaluation programs, and we've been talking about that. The state is going to come out with a model. We are working very aggressively on a model that will be true to Region 1 and unique to Region 1. We'll be working with frameworks of Charlotte Danielson. If you want to look up Charlotte Danielson, her book is Enhancing Professional Practices Through Frameworks, Teaching Frameworks. We'll use hers as a foundation because we think it's very thorough, but we also want to add to it. That'll become sort of the base of our program, and we'll build on that. We will be working on that in June. We hope by December, if we choose to file a plan, it's ours, it's unique to us, we'll have it ready. In December, that we believe the plans will have to be filed, or you will have X number of weeks to accept the state plan. And we want to be ready just in case we want. Now, if their plan's better, then we will want their plan, obviously. Talks about the new requirements, the remediation plans, local plans for remediation, status reports on local evaluations. There will be a pilot program this fall. I believe they selected 8 districts interested in starting the program, and they will be using a pilot program through UConn, actually. There'll be evaluation training. We will go through an evaluation training program this spring and in the fall with all of our administrators and as many teachers that wish to join us. We'll probably do the same thing. Mm-hmm. We'll be spending next year teaching teachers about the framework, so we have a common language when we're in a conference, administrator to teacher. We can actually have a conversation about what we saw in the classroom, what the teacher believed was the strength of the lesson, and we'll be talking the same language. We think that's an important part of our profession that needs to be defined and described. There'll be ongoing opportunities. There was some work on teacher tenure and termination. It requires the superintendent to incorporate evaluations into decisions about granting tenure. We would do that anyway. That wouldn't be new to us. To terminate a teacher for cause. It streamlines and shortens the teacher termination notice and hearing requirements, and specifies that most deadlines in the process must be counted in calendar days. Under both current law and the bill, the tenure and termination provisions apply to all certified professional school board employees below the rank of superintendent. And that's actually what it is now. And that group is collectively defined as teachers. Granting tenure, a law to attain tenure in a particular school district, certified employees must have completed a specified period of continuous service with the school district and must be offered a contract to return the following year. In Connecticut, tenure is 40 years. If you don't have that contract to return in the following year, you're not tenured, absent that contract. And then there's grounds of teacher termination. There's really no changes there in the law that's evident to me. Termination hearing requirements and procedures, again, there's lengthy detail on that, and I'm not going to go through it. It talks mostly about timelines. Calendar day provisions, a minimum 90-day period of required work for boards of education before the teacher is covered by the tenure. We all know that. You have that 90-day window. Once we hire a teacher, they're in that 90-day probationary period, and that's not a change. There's some school superintendent certification waivers, ways to appoint as acting superintendents without proper certification, and there can be a superintendent certification waiver. It talks then at length about the cost share grants, the minimum budget requirements, and minimum budget reductions. There's a good deal on the magnet schools for non-chef magnet schools, again, trying to support and encourage school choice. There was an increase in grant funding for our agricultural science students, so for every student we have in the program, we actually receive new funding for. And I think you see that on the revenue side of there. We have more agricultural money coming in there than we thought we were going to get. Summer school and extended day grant phase out for former priority schools. So they were funding summer school programs for a lot of priority schools. That's being phased out. I'm not sure I know all the details on that.
Will that affect us?
I don't think that would affect you in any way.
Just a priority.
Just a priority. Yeah, it won't affect us. Technical high school systems, they have a new governing board, a new superintendent, there's a budget procedure outlined for them. A lot on the state, it reminds me, the State Department website is very interesting. Intensive reading instruction is again a reoccurring theme. Minority students for special education, again, trying to not over-identify special education needs. And again, it goes back to the kindergarten through grade three. And I'm going to stop because it's just about the end, I think. Information sharing was an issue. Teacher tenure continues to come up as an issue. There's a Performance Evaluation Advisory Council called PEAK. That's the group that's working to develop that model teacher evaluation plan. Teacher tenure, teachers have their contracts automatically renewed from year to year, can be dismissed only for statutorily specified reasons, and have the right to bump non-tenured teachers from positions for which the tenured teachers are qualified if the tenured teachers' positions are eliminated. By law, teachers and school administrators below the rank of school superintendent attain tenure after 40 school months. 4 years of continuous full-time employment with the same Board of Education if their contracts are renewed for the following school year. Teachers who attain tenure with one Board of Education and who are reemployed by the same or another board after a break in service attain tenure 20 months. So if you're previously tenured in Connecticut and you're hired by another board, you don't wait the 4 years, you have to wait 2 years and 20 months. And that's not new. That's pretty much the way it is right now.
Questions.
Questions
for
sorry
Portia
about
on
that, but that was so long.
Fascinating, scintillating.
Sorry,
Rita.
That's it for me.
Okay.
Just really quickly, in the beginning there, did I hear or mishear maybe that they're still going to try to provide financial incentives for
regionalization?
Regionalization.
Absolutely. There's a study group. Is going to
it hasn't
look
passed.
At.
It's in committee.
So that's going to be studied and looked at next year as what could the state do to probably encourage and support consolidation of schools or reorganization of schools under 1,000 students.
But they're looking at it by January of 13th, so
right.
Not long.
Not really very long, actually.
Huh?
So none of those actions will happen except the study. That makes sense.
Yeah.
You heard. Yeah, that's it.
Well, this year anyway.
Yes.
True. The technology plan approval. Do you want to summarize what we're doing with this? We're just, the difference is the vision statement that was inserted.
Mm-hmm. Right. Last time we talked at length about the technology plan, one thing that came up was the vision statement didn't seem like it was a good match, and truth was, it wasn't a good match. It was a different part of the technology statement, which had actually been put into the under the vision statement. So
copy and paste errors.
We found the right part, and we put it where it belongs. So
okay.
Hopefully you've had time to review it, and it does sound more like a vision statement.
Yeah,
so.
Anyone have any questions or comments on the vision statement, or additional comments on the technology plan? Because you're looking for us now to approve it.
Yes, it has to be approved and sent forward.
I just had one on the vision statement. I was disappointed that there wasn't something in there about using technology to network across space. Because, you know, we are isolated here, and to connect to other peoples and other places.
I sort of saw that in, because I was looking for that too, and when I got to the last word.
Communicating.
Use technology as a tool for communicating. I said, all right, well, that's the word.
Yeah, I suppose. Just because the vision statement, the purpose up at the top expresses thoughts about what a future technology-rich education environment will look like. And without that being stated specifically, communicating can just mean that I'm pretty good at writing a letter to, you know, or communicating my report, or, you know what I mean? But it doesn't really get in a vision for using technology to really pool, you know, ideas from across spaces and to connect our little, pretty much homogeneous community with more diverse communities. And I just see technology as being very good at doing that.
I think, if I could just respond, I think there's areas in here that you can sort of glean that. I mean, I admit that it's not stated directly, but giving students the must be able to access and understand, manage, interpret, evaluate, and create information. I mean, I think that's what you're talking about essentially, is being able to share information. And you know, in no way is it just within our school, but just it's everywhere. And I think also technology in its nature, further down it says that there's going to be an integration of technology across the curriculum. So I think that's the purpose of integrating the technology, so that we can, you know, increase the curriculum, communicate, get other resources. You know, it's the bigger picture piece, Amy. But
okay.
I agree that it's not spelled out there, but I feel like it's woven in more so.
Other comments or questions?
Oh, good, you're back. We're about to vote on the technology plan.
Is there language that would radically change it that you could suggest?
Well, communicating and connecting to, I had wordsmithed that.
I would entertain a motion to accept the technology plan.
I move that we accept the technology plan.
Is there a second? We have problems with the technology plan still?
No, I'm just trying to be sensitive.
Oh, that's okay. I mean.
All right, I'll second.
Okay, is there further discussion?
Jennifer, may I just say, since Pam Sangster is here, I just wanted to say thank you to Pam. She has spent an enormous amount of time preparing this plan for Salisbury, and I just wanted to thank her publicly for her tremendous efforts. Thank you, Pam.
So we have a motion on the table. It's been seconded. All in favor of the technology plan, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you all for reading and putting the time in and commenting. I think, do we do this annually or is it every 2 years or 3 years?
Three.
5 years.
It used to be five.
Shortened it to three.
Three
now.
It's three.
Yeah, it used to be five.
I liked it at five.
You get to do it again.
I wonder. And it's due like by June 1st or something, right? Is that the?
We want.
I mean, it's getting a little.
We want to send them.
I was just thinking it might be, especially in the vision statement phase, it might be nice for us to be a little, I don't know, not more involved necessarily, but more apprised a little earlier on in the big picture stage. No, we sort of got it last month, and
right.
Diane was able to explain where the goals had come from. But I don't know. I kind of felt like, and I think seeing the vision statement yesterday or Friday, whatever, it would have been nice to have a little more input in the big picture stuff.
Right.
In the big picture stuff, we don't need to micromanage, but you know, like to be able to say that we'd like to be more connected to the internationally or the broader world, I think would be.
I think you can still do that. This has to go to the state because the state's requiring us to apply.
Right.
It doesn't mean that you couldn't work with Pam and Chris to do just that, enhance it, make it better. You know, they're looking for X, Y, and Z, and you can modify and change as you go along, is my understanding. And things do get changed year to year. And I think it would be a great discussion to have with the board about where do you see Salisbury Central going with technology, ultimately. Do you have a vision, and what are the priorities? And certainly, I think reducing isolation is very critical for our children.
I think I can say we'll be looking forward to having those conversations in the fall, because we've already started discussions, particularly in our middle school, about things like bring your own devices for students and how that would look. And you know, we may have to do some
Policy
work. To make that happen.
Yeah, excellent.
I'll look forward to speaking to the board about it.
Okay.
So I wouldn't consider this sort of forever or this is the last time.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I voted for the plan. Yeah. I just, you know, having a quick look at it. I just would like it to be, you know, really a lofty vision.
Yeah. We can do that. We can still do that.
Okay. Thank you, Pam. Amy, Wellness Advisory Council report.
Yeah, just quickly, our wellness challenge ended today. People have to get their forms in by Wednesday, and the names are going to be pulled for prizes. We have pool parties, thanks to Laura Bushy, who organized lifeguards, and Hotchkiss School. Just hallelujah, they've been wonderful. Sue and Chris did a lot of logistics, put together announcements, and your support really helped make it be hopefully successful. We'll see how many forms get turned in. In terms of the cafeteria, the Survey Monkey, and then we did a hard copy that went home to every student. And it was interesting because the Survey Monkey, we had a lot more respondents, 102, only 31 returned the hard copies. And
was the hard copy the follow-up to the Survey
Monkey?
It was a follow-up.
It was the
same
thing. Said the...
with the results.
The Wellness Council, here are the results, right. And the Wellness Council is considering recommending such and such. What do you think of these recommendations? And the hard copy came back even stronger in their support for making changes. And the biggest controversy, chocolate milk, remember the book, The Chocolate Wars? in the Survey Monkey, 59% said sometimes or never should chocolate milk be offered here. 41% said always. In the hard copy, 74% came back sometimes or never be offered, 23% always. So that was a change. Ice cream and snacks, they were for changing that. So at our last council meeting, the council approved making a recommendation to this board that chocolate milk be offered twice a week, and the suggestion was maybe Monday and Wednesday, and ice cream once a week on Friday. The council would also like to recommend that we go beyond state requirements in terms of the snacks being healthy, not only low fat as the state requires in calories, but also looking at preservative and food additive free colorings and some flavors. So that's what we're bringing to this board.
Now, is that something Joe can do easily? I mean,
I think some changes have already been made in the snacks.
And one of the questions on the survey was, if we were to make some modifications, would you be willing to pay more? And most people,
83%
were willing to pay more.
Yeah.
So I think cost was probably the biggest factor in, I mean, would have the most impact on whether or not you'd be able to do that, correct? And
right. I mean, you know, making these changes will definitely change the revenue of volunteer revenue. And we still have to do our new lunch contract with the food service provider. And Brian and I have talked about we're going to have a special meeting in June to be able to do that because of the process we have to go through. And I talked to Brian about, at that time, we're also going to have to look at price equity, which is something the state requires us to look at. And looking at this will allow us to kind of look at the whole program and decide if and how much we'll have to raise the price of lunch.
We were going to have to go up anyway, weren't we? Because of the price equity? 5 cents.
Yeah.
What price equity?
Let's see if I can explain this simply. The state of Connecticut reimburses us a certain amount of money for every lunch, free lunch that we serve. And the state of Connecticut wants to make sure that that money that they give us goes to paying for the cost of providing or creating those lunches for those free students and doesn't supplement the meals that are made for full price students. So in other words, they don't want school districts to say, we only have to charge $2.30 a lunch because we get so much from the state for our free kids that we can use some of that money to keep the cost of the full price lunches down. So they have a threshold price of $2.51. And they ultimately want every lunch program in the state to charge at least $2.51 per lunch. And they are allowing schools to increase their lunch price in 5-cent increments. So you don't have to go like us. Last year, we went $2.25 to $2.30.
instead of going from 225 to 251.
Right.
So we're allowed to do it in 5-cent increments. So we have to look at that again and say, you know, do we want to raise it a nickel? Maybe we need to raise it more because we're not going to sell as much ice cream and snacks because of the healthy choices and the new requirements by the National School Lunch Program. Food is going to cost more, so Joe Burns is going to charge us more. So it's going to be a very complicated conversation about what we do about the price of lunch.
Bring your spreadsheets. I mean, it's amazing how complicated it gets.
Although that was very clearly explained, Sue. That was good.
But it's good that the Wellness Committee has made their recommendation because now we can take this into consideration when we look at what we might have to increase the price of lunch if we know that there will be fewer sales of ice cream and snacks.
But we do try to keep the lunch affordable. We really do.
Yeah.
We've made that effort.
Does the high school sell the milk? I'm curious.
They do. They have different kinds of milk. Mm-hmm.
The reason I ask is because the Wellness Committee, I know, didn't deal with it this time, right?
There was some, soy milk was brought up, and as I recall, Joe thought that it was too costly to be feasible.
And I'm just questioning, because since we're going to have to go through this anyway, is it...
They have special little containers of different kinds of, and this must be, I don't know, four different things.
I just heard a lot of parents saying it, and it's like...
There were a couple of them written little ones came back with what about soy milk and rice milk.
I don't think she will. I'll have to check.
I don't know. Anyway.
I'll check.
There was discussion of water coolers being available. You know, I mean, there's been lots of brainstorming, and we'll continue our work in September when we meet again.
Great. Yeah, I only knew the contract. I didn't realize we were going to have to deal with this over the summer. So.
Okay. Anything else on the wellness?
No. Just another quick question. So, do we bid out to contractors to provide food?
Well,
one
of the things that we're in the middle of now is that...
I thought you were going to say in the middle of nowhere.
Well,
that too.
Feeling a little bit that way right now. We have had a bid contract that we have used for many years. And because of the new legislation for all of the new requirements that we have to start July 1st, when I spoke to Sam Herrick about it, we agreed that it would be a good idea to send our bid contract to the state for review because we wanted to make sure if there was any kind of language in there that needed to be in there because of the new legislation, we wanted to make sure it was in there. And we kind of opened a can of worms. And what we got back from the state was so over the top as far as what we, I mean, they sent us a document that was like 27 pages long that is really meant for a huge food service management company that, so right now I'm trying to contact the gentleman at the Department of Education to try to see if we can come up with something that's a happy medium. And it's proving to be difficult to get in touch with him. And the problem is we need to have a new contract signed and in place by June 30th when the old contract runs out.
Wow.
So, you know, traditionally we have this bid contract and we advertise it for a few weeks and, you know, traditionally Joe Burns is the only one who puts in a bid on it. So it's usually a pretty easy.
I mean, we had in previous years, a couple of years ago, we had one other bid and they were so far apart in terms of what they were going to offer and what the price was, and when we standardized, you know, when we went back and said, all right, here's what we're really looking for and provided more detail, the other person dropped out. So
that's fascinating.
So we're trying to find out if we can create this document for our individual needs because the other document is so cumbersome and would require Joe to provide so much documentation, and I mean.
Okay, Stephanie needs to go soon. If you guys have specific lunch questions, maybe you can talk to Sue, but let's move on. Chris, you wanna talk about the calendar?
Yes, I left at your seat a copy of the proposed Salisbury calendar for 2012-13. All I did was take the already approved Region 1 calendar and just scratch in the days that would be different. I just put a star on the months that have something that I want to tell you about. So in September, we have a half day early dismissal teacher PD day. That's September 19th. November, our 14th and 15th are parent conferences, those are early dismissal days. January 18th is another teacher PD day, early dismissal. March 26th and 27th are, again, our spring conferences. And then May 24th would be an early dismissal for teacher PDs. So those are the days and schedules that we sort of follow annually. We have three early dismissals for teacher development. We have two half days in the fall and spring for parent-teacher conferences. So we put the calendar and we are proposing these dates to the board.
And you want this approved?
Yes, please.
Is there a motion to approve the calendar?
Move to approve this calendar.
Second. Okay, thank you. Any discussion of the calendar? All in favor of approving the school calendar, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Amy, do you want us to approve or officially make a motion?
I don't know if our board makes policy on the snack program.
No. Well, no, not at this meeting. Yeah. I mean, we'd
no,
have
you'd
to
be
do
in
that.
June.
Yeah.
Yeah. Probably.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, the healthy food certification.
We do need that.
So this is, Sue, do you want to walk us through that? And if we get to that, that's a motion that.
This was our first year doing it this current year. I have not had any complaints or concerns from anybody. It seems to be working very well. It's mainly focused on the snacks and the ice cream that are sold in the cafeteria, and I think Joe has a good handle on what he's selling. As Amy said, the Wellness Committee is kind of encouraging it to go above and beyond the healthy food requirements, which is fine. And this is just a revisit every year. The Board of Ed needs to decide if they would like to continue with the healthy food certification. The Board of Education, as part of their motion, can exempt special events that meet three criteria. They meet after school hours or on the weekend. The sale of the foods are done at the place of the event. And that it's not through a vending machine or a school store, which is fine for us. And what that does is that allows the eighth grade dances to sell candy and soda, or the SOAR quiz bowl to do a bake sale, that kind of thing. And part of the healthy food certification, it does cover extras, so they have to abide by the requirements, which Rachel has been happy to do, and also the PTO. For example, this spring, their butter braid fundraiser, they could not send the butter braids home with students because the students were not allowed to transport them home. The parents had to come pick them up. And they seemed to work that out okay. Wasn't the best situation, but it was doable. So it's just a matter of the Board of Ed deciding whether they would like to continue to do it or not. We do get compensated financially. We get an extra 10 cents for every lunch that we sell. Mm-hmm. As a reward for doing the healthy food certification, so there's a monetary incentive.
Mm-hmm. And on principle, it seems to be the kind of thing we should support since we've got so much invested in it.
Yeah, and I really have not, except for the butter braid with the PTO, that's the only sort of glitch that has happened, the only thing that's been an inconvenience.
Okay. So any more discussion on the healthy food certification? Or would someone like to make one of...
I will make a motion to approve the participation of Salisbury Central School in the state of Connecticut's healthy food certification program for 2012-2013 school year, while permitting the sale of foods to students that do not meet the Connecticut nutrition standards, provided that one, such foods are sold in connection with an event occurring after the end of the regular school day or on the weekend, and two, such sale is at the location of the event, and three, such foods are not sold from a vending machine or a school store.
Is there a second to that motion?
I second it.
Any further discussion on the motion?
I don't know if this, I don't think it contradicts the motion, but just a question about the better choice recommendations that are in the handout.
Page three.
On page three. Does our participation in the healthy foods program, this better choice recommendation is in addition to meeting the specific requirements of the Connecticut nutrition standards. Does our participation in the healthy food program also allow us to participate in the Better Choice recommendation, or do we have to make a separate motion?
No, I think
to
this
participate.
I think this in this document is what Amy and the Wellness Committee are talking about going above and beyond. It's a recommendation that they're encouraging people to go even further than the healthy food requirements.
But we don't need to make a motion to do that.
No.
These aren't required by the healthy foods.
Right. But we don't. I just didn't know if we needed to do anything above and beyond as far as
Okay, so we've got a motion on the table and seconded. All in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, that motion passed, and there's a beverage motion.
Yeah, beverages are not included in the motion that you just passed. We have to do a separate motion for beverages.
And so I do make a motion to permit the sale of beverages to students that do not meet the Connecticut nutrition standards, provided that one, such beverages are sold in connection with an event occurring after the end of a regular school day or on the weekend, and such sales at the location of the event, and three, such foods, such beverages are not sold from a vending machine or a school store.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, motion passes, thank you very much. Committees for certified and non-certified contract negotiations. We have a double excitement this year in that we're going to be negotiating both certified and non-certified contracts. They sometimes overlap, sometimes they're 2 years, sometimes they're, they used to always be 3 years, and so they weren't the same year, but we did the teachers 3 years and the non-certs 2 years, and so now they're both coming due this year. I think Brian and I are going to do the certified contract negotiations, which will start in the fall, or would be expected to start in the fall early. And Brian is looking for someone who might be interested in participating in the non-cert negotiations, which will start hopefully in January, although sometimes that gets later. So if you're interested, please talk to Brian about that. Now, what do we need to do about the attorney?
If you are going to use or continue to use Craig Muser, you would have to ask that we do that. You'd have
so
to
we look,
make
we look
a motion
for that
to accept him as your.
So I don't know any of you. Have you worked with Craig before?
No.
So I was involved with Craig has been our attorney for a number of years now, going on
a long time.
And I've worked with him on the embezzlement situation we had, and I've worked with him on the certified contracts last time, and he is really, really, I think he's really good.
He was here.
He was the one, yeah, he talked to us about
the teacher,
the most recent teacher issue. He's been great. He seems to be relatively good value as attorneys go. His hourly rate is less than a number of other attorneys around, and yet I've always found him to be really competent. He's very responsive. I mean, I would suggest that we go with him. He knows what we're doing because he's negotiated the past number of contracts, and so he's got continuity with them. So unless anyone has reason to the contrary, I think it would be worth going with Craig.
Motion to approve.
So moved.
Is there a second for that? Okay, all in favor of using Craig Muser as the attorney for certified and non-certified negotiations this coming year? Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you very much. Is that enough on that?
Perfect.
What do we need to do on enumeration? Is that just a report or do we vote on it?
In your packets, I believe, is the enumeration report for this year. It was prepared by our enumerator, Patty Stevens. And
yay,
I would just
Patty.
Like to say thank you to Patty for her hard work. It's like being a detective to find out all those numbers. So
I heard you had a 5-year-old in
there. Exactly. She works very hard on it. So this is just a breakdown of students by age and those are which are attending public or non-public schools. It's a nice piece of data for us. I think it helps us understand, how many kids are in town versus how many kids are here at Salisbury Central and maybe in other places. So.
Okay.
A question. I'm sorry. I'm just curious. Do any of these homeschooled kids participate in SOAR or school athletics or any of that?
Not with SOAR.
No SOAR, and they are not in our athletics. Not our school athletics. They have been in our Cub Scouts, at the Cub Scouts in the past, and those type of organizations, but not as far as our school programs.
So you're going to accept the report?
So, any other questions? I would entertain a motion to accept the report.
Move that we accept the enumeration report.
Seconded. Thank you very much. Any further discussion? All in favor of accepting the enumeration report, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you very much. All right, so the last piece of business is the Cable Advisory Committee representative. Now, Amy has served on this for the past 2 years. Amy, would you like to share your experience?
Only since January.
Oh, since January, for the past 10 months.
Yes, and
7 months.
5 months.
We all know Amy.
She hasn't started yet.
We had one meeting, which was really a non-meeting. It was just to say we had a meeting, and we're having a change of leadership at our next meeting in June, which it seems will probably be a good thing, because it hasn't been, to my understanding, and from the feedback I got at the meeting, a very
active
governing council, advisory council. So I'm looking forward to the June meeting and seeing, and I'd be happy to serve.
Great, so you're willing to serve again? Mm-hmm. Would someone like to nominate Amy to serve again, please?
Nominate Amy to serve again.
And I enthusiastically second.
Excellent. Any further discussion on the nominations? Do we need to have a nomination to close the nomination?
No.
I was just at the town meeting.
We'll be happy to.
So all in favor of electing Amy to serve as our representative to the Cable Advisory Council, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstaining? Thank you very much. The motion passes. Is there any further business to come before the board at this time? All right, motion to adjourn.
Well done, Jen.
We almost got to it.
I was talking faster at the end.